Thank you, Brenda, on the organ. We often don't thank our musicians enough, and they do a wonderful job in our church. Well, good morning. I want to extend a warm welcome to our members and our visitors alike. Could I see a show of hands of how many people are visiting with us today? Some people here, April, not a visitor, but anyway, welcome to all the visitors and also to our internet viewers. We want you to have a blessed Sabbath day, and so early Happy New Year to you. You may have noticed that our usual newsletter wasn't available as you came in. That's because our church office was closed for the holidays. But if you want to see the announcements or what's on the calendar, you can go to our Madison Campus website at madisoncampus.org, all one word, madisoncampus.org. Also, there is no fellowship dinner today because of the holiday. So if you see some hungry-looking people next to you that you don't recognize, invite them home for dinner. They could very well be fleeing the snow up in Michigan and headed down to Florida. Or you might find that they've been members here for longer than you have. So it's always fun to get acquainted with those people that we haven't met before. If you look in front of you in the back of the pew, there are blue prayer cards. If you'd like to share a request with our prayer team, fill one out and place it in the offering plate as it comes by. Now, one very important announcement that you'll be hearing more about is this: the week of prayer that's starting next Sunday, January 8th, and it'll run each night through Sabbath, January 14th. Our deaconesses will be serving a light meal starting at 5 o'clock, so if you're getting off work and you can get there 5 or 5:30 or 6, that there'll be a light meal prepared for you, and prayer meeting will begin at 6:30 and end promptly at 7:15 so the children get the parents get their children to bed on time, and some of us more mature folks can get to bed on time too. It's very important that we start off the new year right. I'm sure Pastor Ken will tell us that the theme is on restoration, and it's just, it'd be so nice if we could have all of you here to come out and support our church for that week of prayer. It's very, very important. Also, I hope that all of you have been getting Pastor Ken's weekly email updates. And if you have not been receiving those in your inbox, you want to call the church office and get on the list, because they're very good. They're loaded with news and plans and inspirational things that you really need to see. So go ahead and give the church office your email address and ask to be included on those. Also, I was asked to give an announcement about Celebrate Recovery. There's going to be a testimony this Monday night by Laura. Celebrate Recovery goes from 6:30 to 9 o'clock. Every Monday, everybody's welcome, but especially if you know people who come to Celebrate Recovery, make sure you tell them that Laura's going to be giving her testimony on Monday night. I think that concludes the announcements, unless something has come up that I haven't been made aware of. I don't see anybody raising their hand for another announcements. Also, we have changed our worship schedule around a little bit this morning due to our special communion Sabbath. And so, as a member of our finance committee, I've been asked also at this time to call for the return of our tithes and giving of our love offerings. So as the deacons come forward for offering prayer, I do want to remind you that today is the last day to count your charitable donations as credits on your 2016 tax returns. And I do see our former finance chairman here, Rick Mangum. He did such a good job of asking for these offerings all the time. We got tremendous offerings. I hope that since he's here, you'll honor him by digging deep. And if for some reason you forgot your check at home this morning, you still have until midnight tonight to get it to the post office, drop it in there, as long as it's postmarked tonight. And also another thing, too, is that some of us older folks may not have known about online giving. A lot of the younger folks who give online, and it's an easy way to do that, and you can still give online till midnight tonight, too. The way that you can do that is, again, go to the website, madisoncampus.org, and you'll see a bunch of things up on top. I think the second one says worship. And if you click on that worship button, a drop-down menu will say online giving. After all, giving is an act of worship, so that's where you'd find it under the worship button. So that's another way that you can go ahead and give, not just today, but throughout the year. If you've been paying attention to the budget line in recent newsletters, you know that we are significantly short of our budget needs this year. And a lot of you probably know that we had quite a good contingent of people that left to start a church plant and gone to Victory Church. And so, you know, that does affect our budget here somewhat. But I am delighted to report that 2 weeks ago, I was able to join them, and our Victory SDA Church is now an official company under the conference. And so we want to congratulate the Victory Seventh-day Adventist Church. However, that means that those of us remaining here need to dig a little bit deeper to help get us back into the black. So I do want to gratefully thank all of you who have so faithfully given throughout the year. You know, we do have a wonderful church school here that we support. It's almost a third of our budget goes toward our church school. And also, we're blessed to have tremendous programs for our young people, including, as most of you know, the Pathfinders, Adventures. We have a great Vacation Bible School program every year. We've got wonderful Sabbath school classes for all ages. We have programs for the older youth. And we also target as many dollars as we can to community outreach and evangelism. So I just want to thank you so much for your continuing support. The loose offering today will be going toward Touch the Future. And if you don't know what that is a wonderful program that helps not only our students to be able to stay in school, but it helps the members of the community that they interact with. And so please be generous in your loose offerings also. Now can you join me then in a prayer for our offering, if the deacons would please stand. Our Father and giver of all good things, we come to you this morning with praise and thanksgiving and adoration for all the blessings you bestow upon us so abundantly. We know that many among us have faced serious health and financial relational challenges this year, yet through it all, you have remained constant and steadfast and true. All that we have is yours. We ourselves are yours. We cannot express how grateful we are for your love and your guidance and assurance of eternal life with you. So now, please accept our gifts of appreciation and love as we return our tithes and offerings to you. Please bless and magnify them for your work, not only here in our church, in our community, but wherever you see fit to use them as we work and wait expectantly for your soon coming. For we ask it in the name of our precious Lord and Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everyone, for his mercy does endure forever. Let us stand to our feet and sing about the wonderful gift that the Lord gave us, the blood that Jesus bled for me. Let's stand and sing together.
Never lose its power. and a hop. This Sabbath morning, I'd like, before we start with the homily this morning, I'd like to go ahead and make you aware of a couple prayer requests that I was made aware of this morning. The first one is for Edward, who is the grandson of the DeVaziers. Their grandson has an autoimmune disease that he's been fighting for a while, and it's had a flare-up, and so they're just asking for prayers for their son, grandson Edward. So I'd like to put him on the prayer list. He's not on our church prayer list because we just found out about it this morning. And I'd also like to ask you to pray for Faye Gibson. Just before first service began, I was told that she had been admitted into the hospital, and I don't have all the details on exactly why she was admitted, but we'd definitely like to be praying for her and her family right now. And the family is asking that if you do happen to know the hospital she's at, that right now she should just like some rest. There may be a time when it would be good to visit, but right now they're asking that you just give her a little bit of space as she's trying to recover from whatever is happening here. So with those things said, would you bow your heads with me and we'll have prayer. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for this communion Sabbath. I want to thank you for each person who's here today. Lord, I want to ask that you would bless us, that you'd be here with us, and that we'd experience your presence. May your spirit live in us and speak to us this morning. Lord, we want to lift up Edward to you. As many of us are parents, our heart goes out to Edward's parents and grandparents as it hurts to watch your child suffer. And so we just want to ask that your healing hand would be on Edward. And we pray that your spirit would be close to him and he would feel your spirit of peace and healing in his life. We pray for Faye, Lord. We love her so much and she means so much to this church. And we just pray that she'll be okay and that the doctors will be able to figure things out and that she would be back home very shortly. Lord, today as I speak, I just pray that you would speak through me. I want to give you permission to say what you want to say, that you would take the preparation that I've put into today, and then that you would do what you want to do with that. And I pray these things in your name. Amen. The rain was coming down as only the rain can come down in a tropical environment. I don't know how many of you have ever lived in a tropical place, but when it rains in a tropical place, it's not like little sprinkling. It's a deluge. And this particular Friday, it had been deluging for several days. I mean, just constant pounding rain that just soaks you to the bone. And it was a little bit disconcerting, to tell you the truth, because the group of people that I was working with, who we'd been doing a church plant together, and we had planned a really nice agape feast for this particular Friday night. We'd arranged a special venue to have it in. It was a small room in the Seventh-day Adventist clinic on the island of Guam. And we'd gone to a lot of trouble to decorate the place, come up with a great menu for the evening, and put a lot of time and thought into how we wanted to go about this particular agape feast. And here it is, pounding down rain. For any of you who've ever planned an event, you know the weather can put a serious crimp on how many people show up to your event. And so we were a little bit worried about how many people were going to show up that evening. And we were thinking about, you know, is the rain going to keep people away? And we have this special event. But we were optimistic. We had a great group of people. And those of us who are getting preparing for this were there getting everything set up when Glenda walked into the room. Glenda was a part of our leadership team of this church plant. And Glenda said, "Hey guys, I need somebody to go out and bring John in." And my heart sank when I heard her say it because I knew who John was. Glenda had kind of this little outreach ministry to homeless people on Guam. And John was one of her projects. John lived underneath a bridge. Not a whole lot of those on Guam, but there are a few, and he lived under one of those bridges. He was wheelchair-bound. He was homeless and wheelchair-bound, and he was ill-tempered, I'll just put it that way. He liked to yell at the cars that went by. He didn't have a Christian mouth on him, if you follow where I'm going with that. And he was ill-tempered, and so my heart kind of sank a little bit. I was like, "Oh wow, okay, great. This is not, you know, maybe this wasn't the right night to bring John." to this little, you know, intimate agape feast communion. Glenda, maybe you could have, you know, brought him to church next week or done something else, but, you know, this is not really, he's not going to enjoy it, we're not going to enjoy it, it's not going to be good. And, but, you know, a couple of the guys said, yeah, sure, we'll go get him. And they went out, and they wheeled him in, and you could hear him coming down the hall. He was a angry, angry man. You could hear him, he was swearing and cursing and just, I don't want to be here, and just going just as loud as can be and yelling, and I don't know why that crazy woman keeps coming and picking me up, and just going off. And I just, yeah, like I said, my heart sank, but it didn't, my heart did not realize how low it could go until they opened the door and wheeled him in. And then on top of the noise was the smell. I mentioned it had been raining for several days. I mentioned to you that John was homeless. I mentioned to you that John was wheelchair bound. Add all those things up and start thinking about that. John smelled something like a sewer because his chair was. He apparently did not take the time to get out of his chair when he needed to use the bathroom. And the smell, and I told you it was a small room. I told you it was an agape feast. If you're not familiar with agape feasts, they're food. You kind of start off eating. I lost my appetite the moment the door opened. I was, oh, this is so not okay. And in he rolls, angry, angry man, smelling like a sewer, just, and it just permeates the room. And so at this point, I was just so upset with Glenda in my head. I was like, what are you doing? This is like, we put a lot of time and effort, and you're absolutely ruining this event. I mean, just, the man doesn't want to be here. Listen to him. Could you just do what he asked and leave him alone and let us have a nice agape feast together and not have it absolutely ruined by this man swearing and stinking and all the, I mean, please. So we all, you know, but being Christians, Christians don't tell each other when they're upset with each other, right? We just inwardly get angry and talk about it behind other people's back. So that's what I did. You know, there was this, I can't believe Glenda brought, I know, stuff going on, right? So confession is good, and I'll confess that's how I was. And so we choked down the agape feast, and I really mean I choked it down. It was, I was not hungry. And we get done with the agape feast, and then we go to the other part of the next part of the service in a typical Seventh-day Adventist service, and that's what? Foot washing. All right, foot washing. And it's at this moment that Glenda has another genius idea. Who's going to wash John's feet? You. You brought him. That was exactly what I thought. I might even have said it out loud. I can't really remember what. But, and then and Glenda pipes, well, I'm a woman and he's a man, so he should really have a man wash his feet. And I'd like to tell you at this point in the story that I said, yes, I'll do that, but the honest truth is I'm not that good of a person. Instead, Wes, one of our other church elders, stood up and he said, I'll do it. And he walked over to John, grabbed a towel, grabbed a basin, walked over and knelt down in front of John, and John cursed him. What are you doing? You get away from me. What are you doing? Stay away from me. And Wes said, I want to help you. I want to take your shoes off. I want to take your socks off and see if I can take a look at your feet, all right? And I want to clean them up. I don't need any help from you, you bleep bleep. Get away from me. Don't you dare touch me. Come on, let me help you. Ah! So Wes takes that just soaked wet shoe, the first one off, and if the smell was pungent to start off with, it became even more so when that shoe came off. Because gravity does its work, doesn't it? If he's using the bathroom in his chair, it flows down into the socks and the shoes. So off comes the other shoe. And then off come the socks. And that was probably the grossest moment of it all, because if you've ever seen somebody whose feet have been wet for days, that have been inside socks and shoes and not come out, you don't just take socks off. Skin's going to come with it. And that's exactly what happened. His feet were just beyond vile. He had toenails that were so long that they were curling. And I looked at Wes, and I looked at those feet, and I thought, oh my. And without any ado, Wes turned to a couple of us, and he said, I want you to go see if you can find some new socks. I want you to go see if you can find some new shoes. I need you to go get some ointment. I need you to go get... And Wes was a doctor, and he started ordering people around, and he worked in that clinic, so he knew it. You go there, you go here, you get this for me, you get that for me. And go get me a pair of clippers. And over the next 15 minutes, I watched the most beautiful foot washing service I've ever seen in my life. Because it was real. It wasn't what we are going to be doing here in a few minutes, where we wash each other's feet that were probably already washed this morning once. Wes washed that man's feet. He bandaged those feet. He cleaned those feet. He put lotion on them. He took toenail clippers and clipped those toenails. Now, you might be sitting there thinking, wow, that guy must have been really grateful. No, he wasn't. He cursed him the whole time. Oh, you're hurting me. What are you doing? Why are you doing that? I'm doing fine. I was doing fine before you started doing this. What are you doing? Oh, stop it. What are you doing? Oh. That, and just constant stream of abuse towards Wes as Wes did this. And that image has stuck in my mind ever since as the essence of what communion is about. I wish I was the hero in the story. I'm not. That's Wes and Glenda, the two people who had compassion on somebody who absolutely didn't deserve it, absolutely did not deserve it. Romans 12:10 says, love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. I'll read that one more time for you. Romans 12:10. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. As we participate in communion today, I want you to stop and really think what this service is about. It's easy for it to simply become a little ritual that we do, a little thing that we check off once a quarter in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, say, oh, I did it, or, oh, I was fortunate and I skipped church that week. And we go ahead and we take the meaning out of what was meant to be an incredibly symbolic and important service. This service is a reminder that each one of us needs to be on our knees serving each other. And not just serving each other, but serving those that are abusive to us and who have been mean to us and who are unkind to us. The Bible does not say that we get credit for serving those who reciprocate. The Bible tells us something quite different. It tells us that we have to love the people who are the cruelest to us and who are the meanest to us. That we have to reach out to them in meaningful ways as a servant. Nothing could be harder. And yet it's what God asks. And Jesus modeled. How incredibly disappointing it must have been for Jesus Christ as he walked into that upper room, realizing that not too many hours from then he was going to be taken into custody by the authorities, and then not too many hours after that he would be crucified and die. How incredibly disappointing it must have been for him after 3.5 years of ministering to his disciples to hear them on that last night together arguing about who was going to be greatest. Who was most important, and realizing that not a single one of them was willing to get on their knees and serve not only their own disciples, but him. How incredibly disappointing it must have been for him. And yet, what did he do? He got up, he put on a towel, and he went around and washed each one of their feet, including Judas' feet. The symbolism cannot be lost on us today. We must remember that we are not only to be loving and kind to those in our church congregation who are loving and kind back to us, but to those who have hurt us the most and wounded us the most. that while it's easy to be disappointed about what isn't happening in our church, the more important thing is what am I doing in my church today? We need to remember that as Jesus broke the bread, he realized what that symbolized, that he realized that as he did it, he was symbolizing something very painful that was about to happen to him, his broken body on our behalf. That out of that brokenness, we would receive wholeness. And out of his shed blood and the giving up of his life, we would receive life. Church family, I want to speak to you right from my heart. I try to do it every time I speak to you, but I really want you to hear me today. Please hear me. This is really important to me. Churches are never better than the people that sit in the pews. If you don't like each other, this church will not grow. If you view this as a once-a-week obligation, you will not grow. In John 17:21, Jesus' last request is of his Father. He says, I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you, and may they be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. You know, your parents' world, your grandparents' world was a rational one. It was one filled with logic. And if you went ahead and told people a rational argument, if you could take them through the scriptures and show them why the Sabbath hadn't been changed, if you could take them through and show them about the state of the dead, they would rationally look at that and say, well, that makes logical sense. I'm going to go ahead and make that change, and I'm going to do it because it's what's true and what's right. My friends, that world does not exist today. That world doesn't exist. If you don't believe me, then you haven't been doing Bible studies with anybody recently. At least not anybody who's not a Seventh-day Adventist. The world we live in today is a fractured world. It's one of division. If you don't believe me, then you haven't been watching what's been happening in the United States. You must have missed the election. Our world is divided, and it's angry, and it's broken, and people hate each other and say the worst mean things possible, and that's often in church too. We tend to look at Jesus' words in John 17, and we view them perhaps not as a prophecy, but I do. Perhaps Jesus was speaking directly to this generation, saying, you know what? A logical knowledge of the truth is not going to win the world over. What's going to win them over is when they see that there's actually something different happening inside the walls of your church. When they see that there are diverse people from all kinds of different countries and lands and ethnic backgrounds and social economic backgrounds that come together, not just once a week, but come together as a church family and operate in love and unity together. That is the proof that a world that is hurt and fractured needs that God is real and God is alive. Because a church that is divided is no different than a nation that is divided. But if you are truly a Christian today, speaking to you from my heart, if you really care about serving your Lord and your Savior, the call from him today is one of unity, is one of setting aside anger and bitterness, and instead choosing to come together and love those that are unlovable. It's one of service. It's one of being on your knees and clipping the toenails of a homeless man. He will never appreciate what you've truly done for him. It's a forgiving the church member who's talked behind your back and slandered your name. It's about forgiving the church for the things that it has done that you're not happy with. It is about setting all those things aside and saying, I want more than anything for Jesus' kingdom to come. And for that to come, I have to love everybody, even those that it is tough to love. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3 says, therefore I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling. For you have been called by God. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. Church family, that's my prayer for us for 2017. Communion, why are we doing communion today? Because I couldn't think of a more appropriate time to have communion than as we end a year and begin a new one. Because that's what communion's all about. It's about washing away the old through foot washing, forgetting what is behind and moving ahead. And it's about taking Christ's blood and body into us as we move into the new future that lies before us. And so on this Sabbath day, as we celebrate communion together, I want to invite you to truly celebrate it. I want to invite you to go ahead and confess those sins that are holding you back in 2016 and leave them in 2016. I want to invite you to leave grudges and animosity in 2016. I want to invite you to bind up the wounds that have been inflicted on you with Jesus Christ's help. I want to invite you to view 2017 as a new year. A year where Jesus will live in you. And what you don't have the strength to do, his body, consumed by you, will give you the strength to do. And that life that you do not deserve, that eternal life that you do not deserve, you will appreciate because he freely gave it to you in spite of who you are. I hope you'll join me. 2017 is going to be a year where we focus on restoration. Restoration is an important biblical concept. And no matter where you're at in your life, you need restoration in your life. Because that which is not being restored is breaking down. And so we're going to focus on that in 2017. But I want to ask you, I want to beg you, as your church pastor, if the things that you're doing are not bringing about unity, please stop doing them. And if you're not sure about how to get unity in your life, how to find unity in this church, come and chat with myself or one of the elders about it. But as a church, I believe we are too close to Jesus' return to be wasting time on the trivial. I think we need to be spending our time on that which is most important, which is building God's kingdom and making sure that everyone that we know has that opportunity to choose Jesus for themselves. We're going to go from here to our foot washing service. If you're not familiar with we call it the ordinance of humility. If you're not familiar with foot washing, if this is maybe your first time to participate in that, it may seem strange. And it may seem kind of disgusting, to be honest with you. But that's precisely why Jesus instituted this. In fact, he asked us to do it because he wanted to remind us that this is an important part of the process of being a Christian. That foot washing represents the washing away of the sins that accumulate in our life. And it also represents the servant attitude that each one of us needs to have towards the other. So I want to invite you to please partake in this service. We have three different locations that you can take part. The first one is a place for men who would like to wash each other's feet. That would be in room 114. Go out these doors, you'll turn right, and then on where the hallway is at, you take another right. It's immediately on the left. There's a sign that says that identifies it. It's room 114. It's Dwayne Brown's classroom, Sabbath School classroom. There will also be a room for women to wash each other's feet. That would be at the end of the fellowship hall. So if you go out these doors and you just follow the hallway all the way until you run out of building, that's where they'll be meeting. And then families will meet just before that in the fellowship hall in a room that's designated for them. So if you would like to wash feet as a family, then that is an opportunity for you as well. Please take part in this. Please take the time to really consider what Jesus Christ has done for you as a servant to you and what he's calling you to do in the lives of this church. It's an honor to be your pastor. I really mean that sincerely. I love this church. Some of you may be sitting there saying, well, do you feel like there's not unity, Pastor Ken? And let me go ahead and answer that. I've never been in a church that had enough unity. I'm not dissatisfied, but I'm not satisfied either. Never been in a church that had enough unity. And so it's one of those things I like to ask for as often as I can, because it's been my experience that too often things fester underneath the surface and never get taken care of. So today, take care of the things that you need to take care of. God bless you. Go ahead and head to our different foot washing places.
Please turn in your hymnals to page 271, Break Thou the Bread of Life.
In the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we practice what's known as open communion. What that means is that you do not have to be a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church to participate in communion. It means that anybody who is a believer in Christ is welcome and encouraged to participate in this communion service. So often I'm asked, is it okay for me to take communion bread and the wine? And my answer is absolutely, if you're a believer in Christ. If you're not a believer in Christ, then you wouldn't want to participate in this particular, in this symbolism. But if you are a believer in Christ, then absolutely we would want you to join us in this service. So this time I'd like to invite the deacons to come in. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, as we participate in this communion service, may our hearts be in the right place, and may we really contemplate what we're doing and what it symbolizes and how much it cost you to give us our freedom. We love you very much. In your name we pray. Amen. I've asked Aaron Mays and Mel Brass, who are both elders here in our church, to share some thoughts regarding the bread and the wine. Aaron is going to start us off by giving a brief thought on the symbolism of the bread that we're about to partake of.
These are God's instructions regarding that meal, the Passover meal found in Exodus chapter 12. That same night, they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Now, beyond the more obvious symbolism of the lamb, I find it interesting that the meal seems fairly nutritionally balanced. And the unleavened bread, especially, is a food made for travel. And even more interesting than that, the methods required to make the food are methods that require very little time, or as little time as possible. Now, the point becomes more evident later on in God's instructions. This is how you are to eat it: with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. In other words, God is saying, I'm about to move, and I want you all to be ready to move with me. Now, I believe that God has that same message for us today. Like the Israelites at the first Passover and the disciples at the Last Supper, today we stand at the intersection of the past and the future, of the old and the new in many ways. God is moving, and we're told that the final events will be rapid ones. And like all of those who went before, we're called to be nourished, we're called to be dressed for action, and we're asked to be ready to move. So give thanks. Take the bread. Eat it. This is Jesus' body, broken for us. Let us remember and be ready to follow the Lamb of the Passover wherever he goes in this new year. The deacons, please kneel as we pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for coming all those years ago and sacrificing yourself for us. We ask that you nourish us with yourself as we go into the new year. Be with us, give us strength as we prepare to be ready to move when you call us. In Jesus' name, amen.
It was the time of the Passover. Blood was on the doorpost. It was very, very important for each one to pay attention. It was the transition time when Jesus met with his disciples. It was Jesus who he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament of my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes." Jesus taught his disciples that life was in the blood. And the Passover wine, untouched by fermentation, is on the table. These emblems Christ employed to represent his own unblemished sacrifice. Nothing corrupted by fermentation as symbol of sin and death could represent the lamb without blemish and without spot. He also said, "I am the vine, you are the branches." He evidently spent time with them talking about the vineyards and how much or how important it was for them to understand that the life of the vine becomes the life of the branch. And it's only as we realize that if we are not connected, the soul is dead in trespasses and sins, and life through connection with Christ is the only way that we can have life eternal. And so we can see that the blood is represented by the vine, the vineyard, by the wine that he told them to partake of, to represent his blood. And it's interesting, the spirit of prophecy makes it plain that after they left that Last Supper, he took them out to the Mount of Olives, and on the side of the mountain, he gave to them another lesson on the vine, because the grapes were reaching over the wall. And he again pointed out to them that this was a representation of his blood that was spilt, was to be spilt. Let us bow our heads, and if the deacons would just kneel again. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given to us symbols of the bread and blood of Jesus, his life, which was given for our salvation. We thank you that you give to us things that we can feel, that we can taste, that is so important to our soul salvation. May we take it with the realization that it will be assimilated into our body, that was on the vine became part of the branches. May it be so in our souls today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
The deacons are going to be handing out the symbols of Jesus' blood and body. And while they're doing that, I want to invite you to think about what those symbols represent. Imagine what Jesus did for you all those years ago and what it means for you today. And I want to invite you also to ask Jesus to have, or to give Jesus permission to work in your life in 2017, and that he'll reveal to you what those first steps of drawing closer to him this year, what those look like as these symbols are being handed out to you. Mark chapter 14, verses 22 through 23, record the Last Supper. Verse 22 says, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.'" Verse 23, Mark records, "Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, 'This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many.'" Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for these symbols that remind us of the incredible sacrifice that you made for us. We are truly grateful that you, the creator of all things, is willing to come to this earth, to live with us so that we can know what you are like, and then to die for us, and that you are willing to die eternally, if that's what it took, so that we could have the option, the choice of eternal life. Heavenly Father, help us to be truly grateful for who you are and what you've done for us. And may we give freely to others as you have freely given to us, we pray in your name. Amen. As we close, instead of a traditional prayer, I'd like to close with the doxology. It's "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." It's found in your hymn book in 694 if you don't know it. And we're going to sing that a cappella. "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy As you leave, there will be deacons standing at the door to take up a love offering for those who are in need in our community. So I invite you to give generously, just as God has given generously to you. May you leave here today knowing that you've been with God, and may you go into 2017 with His blessing. God bless you. As you leave, there will be deacons standing at the door to take up a love offering for those who are in need in our community. So I invite you to give generously, just as God has given generously to you. May you leave here today knowing that you've been with God, and may you go into 2017 with His blessing. God bless you.